Now, this is the advantage. Otherwise, we develop all these evil forces in our mind because of our physical body. For too much enjoyment, entertainment, amusement, indulgence, but they are not important for our living, for our survival. So we are going on adding more and more. So we have gone crazy. All the while we are thinking how to enjoy, how to decorate, how to find out modern fashion. This is the nature of our mind. Then how can they concentrate on the real nature of life or the phenomenon of life? Never think. So they behave like self-hypocrites. They want to hide the facts and show an artificial physical body, but inside they maintain so many poisonous, dangerous things in the mind. In Dhammapada you might have read, the Buddha has said, Atthinam nagaram katam mansalohita lepanam yatta jaracha machucha mano makkocha ohito. In these sayings of the Buddha, he says, this physical body is a small town, a nagara. Atthinam nagaram katam. So the bones we use as a wall to protect. Atthinam nagaram katam. By using the bones we made walls to protect the town, nagara. Then mansa lohita, flesh and blood, we use as plaster to cover the wall. Think whether Buddha is right or wrong. So this is a small town. The structure, the bone, is a wall. And this wall or fence is covered by using a plaster. To make this plaster, we use flesh and blood as cement and water, or mud and water. Then, to strengthen this, we use more wiring here and there. Piece of wires, the veins, blood vessels, we use to support this wall. Then inside this we put or we cultivate yatha jaracha machuj, decay and death inside there. So decay and death never come from outside. Inside this city, we have already planted decay. After building, we can see slowly crack and certain break here and there. That is called decay. Then, after decaying and decaying and changing and changing, death takes place. But in inside this mano makkho ca ohita, we have planted our pride, greed, anger, jealousy, ill will inside. This is natural. Those who can understand the real situation try to change the situation a little bit. In place of anger, they use kindness. In place of jealousy, they develop sympathetic feeling towards others. Instead of craze or craving, they develop contentment. And they are the people who really can make use of this small town that we have built for our own benefit, but others never gain anything. So they can abuse and misuse this physical body by using all evil forces. The same thing the Buddha has explained in another discourse. So those who want to go for their deep meditation, this method is important. Otherwise, their meditation can become very artificial meditation. Never penetrate into their mind. Realizations never appear in their mind. And the appearance, this create this natural feeling. Now when you attend a funeral, the person either related to you or a friend of yours, you have seen this person earlier. You know how he lived, what he has done. You know whether he is good or bad. You know whether he is ugly or pretty. So when you look at that dead body, after 2 or 3 days' time, how do you feel? Can you see any of those good and bad qualities in that physical body? They are no more. Only amongst those four elements that I explained the last Friday, three elements remain for a short while, then reduce another one, and then two elements, solidity and fluidity. Fluid also disappears after, say, about 1 or 2 months. No more fluid. Then solidity. Solidity, flesh also no more, also disappear. When the fluid disappears, flesh also cannot remain there. Then remains only a skeleton or bones. And how long these skeletons can remain? Few years. After that, that solidity also disappeared. Because we have seen certain graveyard after digging and do some exhumation to extend the main road, about 40 of them in 1958, I think, yes, the Lockyer Road. And many of these elders could remember the period, the time, how many years ago. So and so was buried here, and so was buried there, and which year, they can remember. And some of them, about 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. And we found out, in certain places there is nothing, only earth, not even a small piece of bone. Certain places we found out two or three pieces of bones. So after 40 to 50 years. And this is the nature of this physical body. The belief that we maintain after burial, that there is something which remains in that place where the body was buried, is the primitive man's belief. There is no truth whatsoever in that belief. To remain something there, one day to get up from the graveyard, to go to heaven or go to hell, a small children's language. But people believe, can't believe. That is why they are very particular about burial. Two religions, three religions in fact, are dead against a cremation, cannot burn, because there is nothing to remain in the grave when the God come and call, get up. Nothing to remain. He come and ring the bell, and then they get up. So they were against. Later they found out that it is very, very difficult for them to maintain. Population is going on increasing. If dead people occupy the whole earth in time to come, living people have no chance to live on this earth. Here you can understand. The Buddha was wise. He never uttered such words, either for burial or cremation, so this or that. According to your convenience, you can do whatever you like. You are at liberty. There are no such restrictions in this religion. So, in the end, they have to surrender. They say, okay, now you can cremate. Now when you go to Hong Kong, see the place where they bury their dead bodies. Such a small island. And they have no place. And certain other countries. So if we maintain this burial for another 500 years, where are we going to live? On this earth. The real freedom that we experience in this religion, we can understand when we take item by item like this. And I think you might have heard this beautiful saying, better to repeat again and again and again, otherwise you cannot remember. So whatever we have accumulated during our lifetime as our property or valuable thing, remains at home when we die. We cannot carry anything with us. Don't think that you can carry anything from this world to next world. It is true. Then you have a lot of friends and relatives. Some of them visit after your death, some others follow up to the crematorium or grave, cemetery. So after burial or cremation, they come back. And nobody wants to go with the departed person. In India, they had some sort of systems called sati. Sati means the husband dies, the wife also must die, sacrifice her life. So she also jumped into the same funeral fire and died. According to their way of life, I think that way is far better than living. Because a woman, assume a very young woman, when the husband dies, she is not allowed to marry again. Strictly prohibited, condemned by the society. And she cannot use any jewelries as long as she lives. She cannot use any beautiful dress. And she is condemned and accused and cursed by the departed man's relative. If this man is a young man, people say this young man had to die because of this lady. So there is no meaning at all. So better to die. Finally, some young wife were reluctant to jump into the funeral fire. Then the relatives all get hold of her and throw her into the funeral fire by force. And they continued this even during the British colonial period. Finally, the British government had to enforce a new law. In that country, it is strictly prohibited to burn a wife of a dead man. By force, they had to stop this. So, burial and cremation. But I told you just now, the custom that they practice in India, even today, when you go to countryside, in the town you cannot see this like in Bombay or Calcutta or Madras or New Delhi, you must go to the countryside. But still they maintain this, they carry their dead bodies and just throw the cemetery and come back. And some people go there and collect few pieces of firewood and burn slowly, slowly. But dead bodies are there always. So those who want to develop their meditation with the monks or laymen, they go, sit down day and night and concentrate, develop their meditation. To them, there are no devils, no spirit, no ghosts, no hantus to disturb them, because they don't believe. If you don't believe, we never experience. When we believe, certain other disturbances we take as created by devils and spirits and ghosts. Not only that, we cannot deny the existence of spirits and some other invisible living being. They do exist. But if our minds are strong, if we are not scared of death, at that time, our spirits also cannot disturb, cannot create any problem. Because of our fear, they also get the chance to attack us. It is natural. I have read an article. I do not know, I have not tested so far, but not so easy to test also. When a fierce dog come to attack you, if you can stand firmly without creating fear in your mind, that dog come near you, smell something and go back without attacking you. Because when we develop fear, the animals get a different feeling and smell, and then they attack us. You know, they are very sensitive. A dog, or even cats also can, sometimes. When the master goes somewhere without the knowledge of this dog, later, these dogs can follow the smell, remain on the way, know where this person has gone. So animals experience this. That's why I told you, the fear that we create in our mind is the mistake. A spirit, so animals or some other living beings get the chance to attack us when our minds are weak. The mind is very strong and firm, others cannot do anything. So through this kind of meditation, we are trying to develop that courage to strengthen our mind, to get rid of this kind of fear, imagination, suspicion, to face the fact. So we are not ready to face facts of life. I told you just now, always we try to show something artificial, not natural. Buddhism tried to analyze this without hiding anything. Because of this, some people tried to introduce this religion as a pessimistic religion, always talk about ill and ugliness of this physical body. But that is the truth. So the Buddha did not want to hide anything, just to please you. Here in this discourse, Satipatthana Sutta, there are few pages here on the same subject. How to concentrate when the dead bodies are in different stages, after few days and few weeks and few months or even few years. Still, there is something for you to concentrate. Piece of skeletons which are scattered here and there, then concentrate. Still, there are certain monasteries and meditation centers, especially in other countries, they bring some skeleton, human skeletons and hang there for all those meditators to watch and concentrate. So the fear that they had earlier slowly disappear from their mind because they get used to it. I think you can remember last Friday I told you, medical students who study anatomy in their universities or hospital, I have seen many of them, when they come home, they carry either small skeleton or the head and keep in their bedroom because they are not scared. They want to study this as a subject. I remember a few years ago, a doctor came from Sri Lanka for a medical exam. So he wanted to stay here for 2 days. Then he told me as a joke, "Reverend, I brought you a very valuable gift from Sri Lanka." Then I thought it must be a packet of tea. So he brought a small box about this much, kept on my table, and opened the box. And I saw the skull of a human being with teeth and eyes. Eyes mean the holes. This is the thing that I brought from Sri Lanka. for his exam, he wanted to study further the details. That is why he brought. To him, he put this in his own suitcase where he kept his clothing. What about you? You immediately collect this clothing and burn, thinking the devil has entered into this one, how can we use this one? So it is very difficult for you to get rid of this, because for generations or thousands of years you have maintained this in your mind. The fear is already crystallized in your mind. That is why we cannot wipe out this fear from your mind. So in our case, we do not suffer from this kind of fear. But we can understand things. We know how to face facts in our life. Now this is another item for us to develop. Kaya gata sati or kaya anupassana. Kaya anupassana reflects or concentrate on our physical body. Kaya means physical body. Then completed various items. There are at least 3 to 4 pages you can find here in this book by explaining various stages of the rotten, decayed, distorted physical bodies for our meditation. In brief, I have covered up the whole area. Kathancha bhikkhave bhikkhu vedanasu vedananupassi viharati. Now we have come to another object for our meditation. This is number two, kayanupassana completed. Now we come to vedananupassana, feeling. Second item is feeling. Vedana means feeling. Idha vikhave bhikkhu sukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyamāno sukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyāmeti pajānāti dukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyamāno dukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyāmeti pajānāti asukhaṁ asukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyamāno adukhaṁ asukhaṁ vedanaṁ vediyāmeti pajānāti. Three items here in our feeling. Sukha, dukkha, adukkha, masukha. Three kinds of feeling. These three words you can understand. Sukha, feeling. Pleasant, feeling. Dukkham, vedana. Unpleasant, feeling. These two we can understand. The other one in between, dukkha and sukha, there is another feeling. That is called adukkha asukha. Adukkha asukha. Neither pleasant nor unpleasant. Free from both. We experience this feeling more than sukha and dukkha. Dukkha we experience more than sukha. Pleasant feeling we experience very seldom. Unpleasant feeling almost every day, so many times. The feeling which is free from dukkha and sukha always. That means whenever there is no complaint, either by using our words or in our mind, whenever there is no such feeling to tell others, now I feel happy, now I feel happy. I feel very nice. In the mind or by using words. Yeah, the nature of sukha and dukkha. So when we keep quiet without telling anything or without experiencing any feeling in our mind at that time, that one is neutral. So we experience more neutral feeling. Awareness of these three kinds of feeling is important. Then how to develop this awareness? This is very important. When we experience physical pain, we are very unhappy. We complain. Not only complain, we blame, accuse, curse, shout, disturb others. So this feeling we experience in two ways, physically and mentally. Unpleasant feeling in our mind we experience more, because always there are a lot of worries, problems, disturbances, burdens, responsibilities in the mind. These things always disturb the calmness, purity in our mind. Certain things we cannot explain, but some sort of unrest, unpleasant feeling we are experiencing, but we do not know why. Sometimes we say, something is bothering in my mind, actually I do not know what it is. That means unpleasant feeling. What is it? Certain hidden occurrences, the memory that we have been keeping under control in our mind, had the chance to come and stir the mind. But we cannot tell what it is. Or we cannot remember what it is. A mental unrest. Some sort of worries are there. Maybe due to certain incidents which were recorded in the subconscious mind, had the chance to come up to the surface of the normal mind, they start to haunt, disturb. That's why when we sleep also, the mind is not free from this. We get bad dreams, nightmare, horrible dreams, we cry, we fight, we get up suddenly, they again start thinking, I had very bad dreams, again worry. So when we sleep also, mind is not free from these disturbances. Only time that we maintain peace or calmness in our mind by realizing the nature of
sukha and dukkha and adukkama sukha, these three feelings, we separate our mind from these feelings for the time being. That means, when we experience very nice, pleasant feeling, either to indulge, to entertain our eyes, mouth, nose, ear, or physical body, these five senses, through these five senses, we catch something, then entertain the mind. Now this is called pleasant. If not, without these five senses, we create some imagination. And these imaginations are very fascinating, fantastic ideas we create in the mind. Then we enjoy. It is some sort of, that means we create, it's called daydreams. Without sleeping, we create dreams in our mind. The subconscious mind projects all these ideas into the mind to entertain. So when we sleep also, we do the same thing. The only difference, the physical body is not relaxed. But the mind is sleeping at that time. Normal mind is sleeping, subconscious mind is projecting. Then create imagination. Present feeling. Six kinds. Then what will happen? Certain feelings that we experience create a temptation. After experiencing this, we want to prolong or we want to continue. If not, we want to have more and more. Then we become slaves to this particular entertainment. No controlling power. After some times, we lose. If not interrupted or disturbed by some others, or stolen by others, then unpleasant feeling we experience. The pleasant feeling is gone. Because of that pleasant feeling, we develop unpleasant feeling. After that, we get jealousy, anger, hatred, enmity, disturbances. Now you can understand why this meditation is important, to control the mind, not to become slaves to any of our senses. When we experience pleasant feeling, definitely we have to face unpleasant feeling because of this pleasant feeling in the end or halfway, if not after a few minutes or few hours or few days. This is the uncertainty or the fleeting nature of our pleasant feeling. So we go mad. Then we are running after mirage to catch. The more we run, the more we get tired, and we may collapse. In the end, nothing. Throughout our life, we go on like this. Because of this pleasant feeling, we completely wasted our valuable human life. But without becoming slaves to these things, we can experience pleasant feeling by realizing the nature of this feeling. How are we going to do that? When we experience this pleasant feeling, we have to contemplate, we have to think. This pleasant feeling that I am experiencing now won't last long. This may disappear after a few minutes or few hours or few days. Therefore, I must have courage to maintain peace in my mind when this pleasant feeling disappears. Now that is meditation. That is what Buddha is trying to tell us. Experience, if it is not a wrong thing, but awareness must be there regarding this pleasant feeling. Then you can avoid so many misfortune or unfortunate situation. If you can experience your pleasure with understanding or awareness. Then let us come to the other side. Unpleasant, pain, ache, we always complain. So when we have such problem, we lose our temper, we change our mentality. At that time there is no cheerfulness, no happiness, and very difficult to maintain the normal human attitude at that time. Either grumble or criticize or condemn or cry or accuse. All these unpleasant expressions we can notice. That is the time that we need this meditation. Not to complain, not to accuse, not to cry, but to understand. How are we going to understand? As long as we maintain this physical body, no one is free from this problem. Whether rich or poor, educated or not, religious or not, makes no difference. No one is free. Now let us take from the Buddhas, Arahanta, saint, other religious teachers, great people in this world, whether they are free from all these things. No? Some of them had more sicknesses, more pains. Then what about me? How can I maintain such attitude that I should not have this kind of unpleasant feeling? Why should I get all these things? Whether you have done good service to others, whether you have harmed others, makes no difference. Because your physical body does not know whether you are good or bad. Remember this. Only mind knows. Physical body does not know whether you are a holy man or you are a thugs or gangsters. Physical body is physical body. Pain and pleasure, physical pain and pleasure is common to a king or no difference whatsoever. And ugly and filthy and dirty impurities of the physical body also makes no difference whether that person is a king or a beggar, same physical body, same element. The Buddha, after serving for 45 years, sacrificing whole life to serve, to guide the whole mankind. It is mentioned during his lifetime he had to suffer 12 kinds of sicknesses. And the last one was the severe, very painful one, before his passing away. And he told his disciple, pain is unbearable, but I thought that I am going to die. At the same time, I realized that my disciples, monks and nuns and laymen and lay devotees, have not yet learned enough to maintain or to develop their spiritual way of life. So by using my concentration, I could manage to suppress my pain for another 4 months. He announced earlier, after 4 months he is going to pass away. But the pain was horrible, unbearable. Because this physical body does not know whether this person is a Buddha or ordinary man. No difference. Only mind. Then he used that mind to control that pain. He cannot stop it completely. It is against the nature. No one can wipe out it. But he controls. So when we develop this meditation, when such unpleasant feeling arises, we can use that mind to control that feeling and divert our mind towards something else. Then we forget this. The feeling, unpleasant feeling, we forget. If not, another method. We concentrate on our pain. We don't want to remove our mind from this pain. We cooperate with the pain without hating. We cooperate with the mind, I mean the pain. Then go on concentrating, concentrating. Pain, 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 pain. I know this is pain. So when we get used to this pain, then the pain slowly going, reducing, reducing. Because this is only a feeling. Reducing and reducing and reducing and reducing, then we forget it. So this is the way how we have to concentrate on our feeling. Then we never become slaves to our pleasant feeling, and we never hate our unpleasant feeling. We never create troubles and problems and difficulties because of our unpleasant feeling. And we also realize these things always going on changing one after the other. Once we experience pleasant feeling, followed by unpleasant feeling, again pleasant. This thing always up and down, up and down. This is the nature of all our feeling. Another method. Pleasant feeling is very nice. But this won't last long. Right? I experience it, I enjoy it, but I don't want to surrender myself to this feeling. I know this one disappears after some time. When the unpleasant feeling or the pain or the sickness come to us, we have to concentrate in the same way. this unpleasant feeling also a temporary one. This won't remain always with me. This may disappear immediately or after some time. So this pain also impermanent. Pleasant feeling also impermanent. Unpleasant feeling also impermanent. But we have to experience this. So we go on developing and developing and developing. That's what the Buddha says. It's not necessary for you to depend on any extraordinary or external forces or energies or God or devil for you to develop your religion, to train your mind. Everything is here. Analyze all these things. There is nothing for you to invite from outside. Concentrate on these existing things, then you can understand things properly. Neutral feeling. I told you, we never enjoy or we never complain. But that, the awareness of that feeling, that means in between these two, there's an interval. Neutral feeling means interval, in between. Like this, when you go and watch the waves, the sea beach, you can see it goes up and again goes down, and there is interval in between. Then another one will come. But that is not entirely different one. The same thing which has gone down created a force to come up. That one goes down and again another one. So pleasant and unpleasant feeling also like waves. If not, the same pleasant feeling goes up and down 2-3 times, change. Then again, change into something else. So in between, there's an interval. This is called neutral feeling. Concentrate on our feeling. Then we can maintain some sort of purity in our mind without developing craving, without developing hatred for pleasant and unpleasant feeling. It will become meditation. Yes. So next Friday, another item. Two items in this discourse, Satipatthana Sutta, the way of mindfulness. Kayanupassana and Vedananupassana. Concentration on our own physical body and the analytical observation of the body to reduce too much of attachments and craving and not to misuse or abuse our physical body. Then Vedananupassana, the nature of our feeling, pleasant and unpleasant, and neutral, three kinds of feelings. Because when we experience very soothing, very pleasant feeling, we want to maintain this. After losing or changing, we create unhappiness, disappointment, frustration. To avoid that situation, when we concentrate on impermanency of this pleasant feeling or the fleeting nature of this feeling, then we can understand. Again, unpleasant feelings always create disturbances, worries. Then we develop aversion or hatred. To avoid this, we try to maintain some sort of unbiased attitude towards our unpleasant feeling, and also we can console our mind thinking, this unpleasant, irritable feeling also impermanent, changeable. So the uncertainty of pleasant and unpleasant feeling. Today, we are going to discuss the third item, that is called Chitta Anupassana, Chitta Anupassana. Concentrate on our own mind. Chitta is mind, Anupassana, concentration. Then how to concentrate on mind? Before we concentrate on mind, we must know what it is. Not knowing the nature of the mind, we cannot concentrate, because we have to use the same mind to concentrate. Because we have got two kinds of mind, only one mind, but different mental faculties. It is like this. When we want to wash one hand, we use another hand. But both are hands. Just like two different mental faculties. So we use one hand to wash or to clean another hand. One leg by another leg, by rubbing, we clean. So in the same manner, we can use one mental faculty to observe the nature of the mind, then analyze. We cannot get anything from outside to observe or to cleanse our mind. Then what is mind? Mind is an energy. It is not located in any particular area in our physical body. The common belief that we have that mind is in our brain or in our heart or somewhere else is not accepted by well-known psychologists and Buddhism. Therefore, the brain and heart contributes in the formations of this mental energy, but not located in the brain or in the heart. But without brain or without heart, we cannot create that energy. So, how did we get this mind? Who created this mind? Because mind is uncontrollable and unreliable.